So South Africa's economy expanded at its fastest pace in 14 years in 2021, rebounding from a coronavirus-induced contraction the year before. According to a report released today by the Statistics Office, Africa's second-largest economy reported a gross domestic product growth of 4.9% after shrinking 6.4% in 2020. In the meantime, South Africa is watching the Russia-Ukraine conflict very closely in areas of export advantage. Olusi Masango is our RISE News correspondent in Johannesburg, and he joins me now for a chat to these developments. Thanks for coming through, Olusi. What is your overall reading of the latest South Africa's positive growth report for last year?
Well, Boson, the South African economy bounced back in the fourth quarter of 2021, you know, following a difficult third quarter, which means the GDP grew by about 1.2%, following a 1.7% contraction in the third quarter of the year. Now, economic growth as a whole rose by 4.9% in line with some expectations. Now, this is a very good picture, Boson, in the fourth quarter performance. More economic activity was then also permitted, and we've also seen in previous quarters. Now, this also means that this is also at a time where the country itself was trying to come back from some of those restrictions that were posed by this global pandemic coronavirus. And we've seen how the GDP itself is starting to also gain momentum. So it would look like there is a silver lining or some sort of a light at the end of the tunnel.
Light at the end of the tunnel. Well, but how was this growth numbers produced despite the hard lockdowns and restrictions of the pandemic last year?
Well, the fourth quarter, Boson, found itself in a rather awkward and peculiar space because it had to contend with restrictions that were put in place during the third quarter. And after that, we saw how the border started opening and allowed goods movement. And indeed, we saw imports increase by about 8.9% and exports increase to about 8.5%. And that is from the side, that is on the side of consumption. And then in production, we saw how the likes of personal services in the health sector, you know, also being a huge contributor, then it is no surprise that due to COVID-19, we saw how health services started contributing a lot in the most in the production sector. Now, this is, of course, the food and non-alcoholic beverages also contributed equally around 0.6%. points because of the hotel and restaurants in the region of about 13.2%, which shows that the economy is really starting to gain momentum and really starting to gain traction, even though it's not where its former glory was. But these are small baby steps in the right direction.
Small baby steps on nearly 5%. What sectors were responsible for this growth, and do you think it will be a mirror for a similar performance in the current year, 2022, or it's going to get bigger?
So, Boson, we've seen five industries that were reported in the fourth quarter of last year. The agriculture sector continued to show resilience with the 12.2% production of animal products. We saw the mining sector decrease to about 3%, showing a decrease in the production of iron ore, gold, and coal. Now, the manufacturing sector increased by about 2.8%, which is mainly production of, you know, chemical products such as plastics, rubber, and petroleum. And the trade sector's increase was also supported by the retail trade sector, which, you know, the motor sector as well, which allowed for more economic activity.
Interesting. I know the July violence and all the looting and all that around the KwaZulu-Natal and all that, would have some impact somewhere there in the GDP numbers, considering the several billions of rands that were lost, including the closure that Massmart, ShopRite and all others went through. Where does South Africa stand? Let's move forward in the ongoing Russian military assault on Ukraine.
Also, it would seem the South African president explained South Africa's stance as far as the Russia-Ukraine conflict is concerned, you know, following that UN General Assembly decision to reprimand Russia for its invasion of Ukraine. But South Africa, you know, came out and said that it was not one of the 104 assemblies, and it was also not one of the 193 of the members that, you know, voted in favor of the resolution, saying the resolution to reprimand Russia did not meet South Africa's expectations. Now, you have the International Relations Department on one hand saying one thing and the presidency saying another, with the International Relations Department saying they will not be taking sides in this matter and saying they'll also not be calling out Russia or trying to some sort of discipline Russia for its invasion of Ukraine. They just said parties must all come to the table and engage in dialogue, and said this was a so-called principled stance that South Africa was taking of giving and ensuring that there could be a peaceful settlement of this conflict that we've seen. So seemingly South Africa choosing to sit this one out, Bosun.
Yeah, but again, I'm sure South Africa is not. President Ramaphosa and the rest of his team are not just folding their hands. Being Africa's most advanced economy, there should be some comparative economic advantage somewhere that South Africa would want to take advantage of this conflict. No one is sure when it's going to end and how, by the way. So it's global economic diplomacy right now. What's the advantage that South Africa could have on the table?
Yes, indeed, Bosun, you're making a very good point. You know, South Africa actually has good bilateral relations with both countries, Ukraine and Russia. And of course, analysts even said that South Africa should leave taking sides to what you would call the so-called big dogs, you know, saying that South Africa must not underestimate its position within the BRICS, because they feel BRICS is still a loose grouping. And South Africa's ties to Russia actually date back to when there was still apartheid, and when politicians from the ruling party, the ANC, on many occasions would also go to Russia at some point, you know, and they're also part of this economic bloc, the BRICS, which is Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Let's also bear in mind that Russia also imported about 1.3 billion rand worth of products last year for the year of 2021, and exported about 458 million rands worth of products from the country. So it seemed that South Africa would be trying to take a rather safe stance in this whole conflict between the two countries.
Interesting. It's International Women's Day, my friend. What are the key issues for women in South Africa's politics, business, and entrepreneurship? What's been said today? How has been reported in the local media in South Africa? Who's making the big speech? What are women in South Africa? What do they really want? What more will they want, by the way?
So, Bosun, on International Women's Day in the country, we've seen how most women organizations in the country have held dialogue sessions as well as conferences on this particular day. They've also went on to bemoan the fact that there is a lack of community support. And they said that, of course, there's also cultural barriers that continue to lock women out of leadership positions. And they said that they are hoping for an Africa that will be, you know, taking its women seriously and have women where they're in a position to be put against their male counterparts. And of course, they went on to reiterate the likes of the Youth Women's League of the ANC, saying they're not really trying to compete with their male counterparts, but they really just merely want to be heard, and said that a lot still needs to be done. And such days as this one, the International Women's Day, should be used as a day to really gauge as well as have conversations around how do women step up to the plate and really become the best that they can be.
Thank you so much. You do have a pleasant evening. Nkolisi Masango, thank you very much for coming through on the show tonight. Our ICE correspondent in Johannesburg.